Hey everyone, I'm Joe Angelino, and I'm really excited to be giving you a brief overview of genetic algorithms. So what exactly is a genetic algorithm? Well, it's within a larger field called evolutionary computing, which is a subset of artificial intelligence inspired by biological evolution and its processes. And more specifically, a genetic algorithm is a heuristic searching algorithm that's based on natural selection and genetics. And a heuristic algorithm is one that gives us an approximate or a good enough solution, but it doesn't guarantee you the ideal solution. And in a lot of real-world applications, it might take way too long to compute and might not even be necessary for an ideal solution. So when would you use one? Well, it mostly deals with optimization, or to get as close to an ideal solution or a combination of things as possible. It doesn't require any derivative information, which we might not know about in a real-world application. We might not know any information about the solution that we're looking for. And it provides a list of good solutions and not just one single solution, which is a big benefit. So let's break it down with the help of our good friend Charles Darwin. And there he is. So we'll be talking about Darwin's famous theory of evolution, but more specifically, his idea of natural selection, or as we all know it, survival of the fittest. So it typically goes in a pattern that individuals within a population exhibit variation in appearance and behavior. And we can see that in pretty much all species, in height, eye color, hair color, behavioral traits. Those with traits most fitting to their environment survive to reproduce, and those survivors pass down their traits from generation to generation, and those generations include mutations to offer more variations in the future. And those variations may make those offspring either more successful or less successful. So the main exemplar are Darwin's finches. He came to his evolutionary conclusion after studying finches on the Galapagos Islands, when he realized at each island, the finches differed in their beak types depending on what food was abundant on that island. And a cruel fact of life is, if you can't eat, you can't live. So the more successful finches lived on. You say, well, that's all well and good, but what does that have to do with algorithms? Well, a lot, actually. We can mirror that exact same cycle in developing our searching algorithm. So we start with an initial population of randomized solutions. We need a function for determining which of those solutions are the most fit or the most ideal. We select a group of the most fit from that population, and those mate, or they swap some genomes to create offspring or new solutions. Then we slightly mutate those solutions for more variety, and that becomes our population for the next iteration. And we know that evolution takes millions of years, and it's an ongoing process. And similarly, our algorithm could, in theory, run for years before finding an ideal solution. So we need to choose a terminating criteria, or when to stop. So we can stop after a set number of generations, say, let this run for 100 generations, and we'll just take the optimal solution. And that's not always a good idea, and we'll see why shortly. And another case to terminate would be when the most fit solution has not changed in a certain number of generations. So each time you iterate and select the most fit, you're getting the same solution back each time. That's kind of a good indicator that you're at a pretty ideal solution. So I wrote a small genetic algorithm for you guys today, and it simulates the infinite monkey theorem. And I'm pretty sure that's looked like all of us at some point as developers. So the infinite monkey theorem is a theory of probability stating that given an infinite amount of time and a monkey typing on a keyboard, it would eventually type all of a given text, such as all of Shakespeare's works. It would take an incredibly long time, but it's possible. So today I wrote an algorithm that would speed up that process. So let's walk through it. Now, we are going through not his whole works, but to be or not to be, that is the question. Our optimal score is the length of this target string, and I just limited the amount of characters we can use for simplicity. The mutation probability we'll see soon, and we're going to use a generation size of 50. So our generate genome function creates a random string the same length as the target. Get gene pool takes the generation size and calls this function for that amount of time to create our first random population. Now our evaluate fitness function. This compares one genome to the target and gives a fitness score of how many characters match. Get single fittest, you give it the whole population and it will return the most fit from that whole pool. Here's our selection function. And in my case, I selected the best half. So 25 of the most fit out of our population are going to be selected. And here's where we cross over. And this is sort of the diagram that I use to implement my crossover, but there's other ways that you can do it. So from that surviving generation, or surviving population, we take two parents, split them down the middle, and create two children as combinations. So the first half of parent one and the second half of parent two, and vice versa. And then we concatenate the 25 survivors with the 25 new offspring. And then we mutate them slightly. Here is where we use our mutation probability. So for each genome, we go through each character in the string, and each character has a 1 in 10 chance of being mutated, where it's just set with a new random character. And this if statement just says, if this character is already correct, just lock it in and don't mutate it, which would just speed up the process. But in a real-world application, again, you wouldn't know the ideal solution to compare it to. And here's where we put it all together. So if you just walk through it, we have our initial population here. We get the fittest from the population. Here's our terminating criteria, where if the fittest is not equal to the optimal score or it's not equal to the target, we get the fittest half. We cross over, make another population of 25, mutate them slightly, get the single fittest of that, and keep checking on and on until we find our solution. And I'm just going to run this code for you guys so you can sort of see how it works. Okay. That didn't do what I was supposed to do. There we go. Okay. And as you can see here, it took 84 generations to find our solution. If you look up at the top, this is our first generation that was a completely randomized string. And just the fact of iterating and keep selecting a string that's closer and closer to our target, we eventually get there. And if I run it again, it'll take a completely different number of times because it's, again, randomized. So some interesting applications. It's used a lot in AI and robotics. It's used a lot in automobile and airplane design. And I actually have another small demo that'll show you how automobile design sort of works with it. And a lot in air traffic control systems and other navigational applications, finding a great route or kind of scheduling. So this is a cool site I found, which uses a genetic algorithm. Let me just explain a few things before we start. So they have a generation, 20 cars in a generation. They're initially completely randomized by their size, their wheel size, and the orientation of the wheels on the shape. They're taken off the screen after a certain amount of immobility, and their fitness is determined by how far they get. So I put this on YouTube just so that I could speed it up a little bit. But you can see in the initial generation, they're like very wonky and not like a real car at all. Imagine driving something like that. Or that. So now this is the next generation, and you'll begin to see how they get more and more successful each time. And then you'll see how the next generation gets more and more similar to the best cars from the previous generation. And so this gray car right here was the most successful car from the previous generation. And we're surpassing how well we did last time. I could watch this all day, by the way. And now you can really begin to see how similar they're getting with just slight variations. But we're clearly getting closer and closer to a better solution. So let me just speed this up again. All right. So here's a point I wanted to make, why I said before why we shouldn't just stop after a certain number of generations. Because as you can see on the graph down here, we actually went down in how optimal this solution is. So it doesn't linearly improve. A graph of a genetic algorithm can and usually will fluctuate. So let me just get to the end so I could show you guys kind of like the graph. I think I ran it for, 10 generations? Yeah. So this is a kind of a great visual representation of how a genetic algorithm sort of gets to its ideal route or how it gets to the best solution. So that's about all I have for you guys. Now, go out there and get your jeans on. Thank you.